Tom, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So, Tom, you inspired a lot of the evolution of medicine and functional forum. You know, your gluten summit a few years ago was the first one to really sort of break through into the mainstream and get over 100,000 people interested in a particular topic. 2 years later, is it all still about gluten?
No, it's not. Gluten is a component, but it's not the primary thing. The reason that we talked about gluten and why I still do include gluten is because it's a primary trigger. The bottom line, as you're going to hear tonight, is all about inflammation and inflammation in the brain and some of the mechanisms that might be causing that. And gluten, if you have a sensitivity to gluten, or actually it's an adverse reaction to foods, any food that you may have a sensitivity to could impact on inflammation in the brain. That's the bottom line. And there's just over 20,000 studies on gluten sensitivity and celiac disease. And the most common system of the body that's impacted is the brain. For every single person that has GI symptoms with the sensitivity to gluten, there are 8 that don't, that the symptoms are somewhere else in the body. And the most common system of the body is the brain.
I know there's been some new science talking about that mechanism, actually happening. And I thought when you told me this last year, I just thought this was super fascinating and need to be on the functional forum.
Yes, yes. And before I say that, I just want to give credit to Dr. Michael Gershon. I believe he's from Princeton, who in 1999 published the book, The Second Brain. And that opened up the world to many of us that there really was something more than just this brain that was controlling how we function. And the things that he said back in 1999 have proven to be so true and accurate. I actually think that our gut is not the second brain. I think it's the first brain in terms of its impact. But a study came out recently that just rocked my world, and I've talked about it a lot since then. And with neurodegenerative diseases, specifically Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, what they know, of course, is that it's these misfolded proteins that if it's Parkinson's, it's alpha-synuclein that gets misfolded. And if it's Alzheimer's, it's beta-amyloid that will get misfolded. And these misfolded proteins have an attraction to certain areas of the brain, almost like a magnet. Alpha-synuclein will go into the substantia nigra and eventually cause Parkinson's. The inflammation will damage the tissue and cause Parkinson's. What they've now discovered is that the production of those proteins being misfolded occurs by dysbiosis in the gut. It's abnormal bacteria in the gut that will misfold those proteins. And from the area of the lumen of the intestines, they go through the epithelial lining of the gut, not through pathogenic intestinal permeability, but by transcytosis. So you don't need to have a pathogenic intestinal permeability, the slang term, the leaky gut.
Yep.
These misfolded proteins will go right through into the submucosa, and they are attracted into the enteric neurons, the neurons of the nervous system of the gut. They travel up the enteric nerves, neuron by neuron, and they get into the vagus nerve, and they travel up the vagus nerve, neuron by neuron, until they get up to the brain. And I haven't seen any studies that talk about how long it takes, but obviously it takes years for that to occur. And they travel up the vagus nerve to get into the brain, causing that inflammation where the magnetism pulls that protein to a specific area of the brain. So what is it that causes the dysbiosis in the gut that then contributes to the misfolding of these proteins? What is it? Well, it's an inflammatory environment in the gut that will contribute to the dysbiosis. Where does the inflammatory environment of the gut come from? It most often comes from what we eat, that our food selections, whether there are foods that we actually have an immune reaction to or they're just bad foods for us, but it's the environment we create in our gut and the bacteria of the gut that will contribute to if these proteins get misfolded.
Absolutely. You know, we were having dinner towards the end of last year, and I just sort of thought, like, this really isn't a problem for neurologists and psychiatrists in a certain way. Like, this is obviously something that they're dealing with, and I have nothing but empathy for the neurologists who are just looking at MS slides all day, and these people are a long way down the track. I mean, but to actually deal with this, to actually cause a situation where we don't have this amount of inflammatory disease, it seems like it's a different type of health professional that's gonna solve this problem.
Here's an example of it. Children with drug-resistant epilepsy, And if you have a child with seizures and they're drug resistant, that means that you've been to your GP, you've been to the neurologist, you may have been then sent to a pediatric neurologist, the drugs aren't working very well. They have drug resistant epilepsy. In the American Journal of Gastroenterology in 1996, they published a paper that showed 50% of the children with drug resistant epilepsy go into complete remission on a gluten-free diet. Wow. 50% of them. But why don't neurologists know this? It's because it's published in a gastroenterology journal.
Yep.
And neurologists don't read gastroenterology journals.
Yeah.
Right? So it requires going outside of our area of expertise and in embracing a discipline, which is functional medicine, that takes into account the whole body.
Absolutely. So, you know, one of the ideas that we came up with, and this wasn't my idea because you're already doing this, is we basically need an army of coaches, community practitioners, instigators, people who are taking, you know, this message to the people and helping people to change. I mean, sort of autoimmune coaches now with this new thing. What can we do together to make that happen? Because this is 2016. I promised in the emails that we're going to be making some big moves here at the Evolution of Medicine to really take this out. And you're the first person I'm speaking to here. What can we do to make this work?
What you're going to hear tonight from Dr. Cass and Dr. Karazian includes the autoimmunity in the brain, that the inflammation that occurs in the brain triggers an immune process attacking self. And so it's the autoimmune cascade that is an important component of understanding where our patient's symptoms come from. So having an understanding about autoimmunity in a deeper sense than just treating Hashimoto's with Synthroid or treating rheumatoid with anti-inflammatories, having a larger scale understanding. The science is very clear that there is a trilogy in the development of autoimmune diseases, right? You have to have a genetic vulnerability. You can't do anything about that. You have to have an environmental trigger that sets it off, the straw that broke the camel's back. And in many of our talks, it has been to consider gluten, but there are many others also. And you have to have intestinal permeability, or the slang term is the leaky gut. And just read the papers and you'll see the studies are out there on this. And so what they say in the studies is you can arrest, and that's their words for it, arrest the development of autoimmune disease by healing the gut. So from a functional medicine perspective, that's why I teach about pathogenic intestinal permeability for the Institute for Functional Medicine, is that it's a critical component to include in the big picture. So what we want is our practitioners to understand this whole dynamic of autoimmunity and that it's a spectrum. You don't get Hashimoto's the day you're diagnosed. You get Hashimoto's years beforehand, slowly killing off your thyroid tissue. slowly developing it, or lupus, or rheumatoid, or psoriasis. They don't occur in a day or a week. Now we know, and you can identify the early spectrum when they've got elevated antibodies before the tissue damage is so extreme that the symptoms are there. And that's what we want to train our physicians on, is how to identify this spectrum in the development of autoimmunity. And that's what we're going to be teaching about this year.
That's so awesome. Well, for those of you who are watching, just to give you a little hint towards what's happening later this year, we want to help you to develop this army of autoimmune coaches. I think that there's definitely a way that doctors and nurse practitioners and can play a role in functional medicine and will play a big role. But I think these other practitioners, you know, could end up working in a neurologist's office, in a psychiatrist's office, actually implementing the dietary changes, because that's not something necessarily that psychiatrists are trained in either. And if we're constantly trying to train the doctors who don't know anything about it in something new, rather just have a synergy of people working together. And that's exactly the point of the functional forum meetup groups. Let's get people in the same room. Let's get them talking. Let's create collisions, as Tony Hsieh would say. I want to thank you for being here. I know you have to run across to a flight, but Dr. Tom O'Brien is the hardest working man in functional medicine, and I would just say from all the time that I've known you, I really appreciate your desire to just go out there and make a difference. You can tell that this is in your blood, and you've got the...
Thanks, James. I'd like to say one more thing,
sure,
if I may.
No, absolutely.
And that is, we all think as practitioners, we need to know how to treat everything that comes in our office.
Yep.
You know, we think we have to handle it all. You don't. You find what you really have passion for. And that's what you dial down and you get really good at. And for the rest of it, you bring on a support team.
Yeah.
And that's a critical component, I think, is that, and I'm going to take the moment here, the opportunity to say this, I believe every healthcare practitioner, every office needs to have a trained registered dietitian or nutritionist on their staff or they refer to, so that you're not handing patients a sheet of paper to say, here, go eat like this, but rather we're guiding them on how to transition their lifestyle into a healthier lifestyle, because food, as we all know, food is medicine, and it's a primary first component in addressing any type of health condition.
Absolutely. Well, that's part of the plan. It's doctors and coaches working together. You probably could have guessed that plan from everything that we did last year. But 2 weeks tonight, on the 18th of January, we are going to be running a special webinar with Tom and myself, where we're going to be introducing to everyone the opportunity to become an autoimmune coach, a certified gluten practitioner. You know, this army of practitioners that can go out and re-educate the population, work with practitioners, and make it happen. It's going to be a fun year.
James, thanks very much.
It's going to be a lot of cool stuff coming up. Let's have a round of applause, everyone at home, for Dr. Tom O'Brien. Thanks, Tom.
Thanks so much for watching. And for more great clips like this, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. I've created a special free video just for you. It's called The 5 Steps to Becoming a Leader in Your Wellness Community. And it'll give you some of the starting points on how to position yourself as the leader in your zip code of your health community. All you have to do is click on the link below.